whoa.
So we're making a movie about toys being alive. This is awesome.
We just wanted to do something that was different.
Sheriff, this is no time to panic. This is the perfect time to panic.
We were too stupid and naive to realize you couldn't do it.
Boss, look, an alien!
Where?
I'm part of this thing that has gone down in cinematic history as lightning in a bottle.
It was quite a revelation.
The rebirth, really, of feature animation.
That day, I thought, this was the future.
You know, it's changed everything.
It's one of the most beloved movies of all time. And tonight, 20 years after its world premiere, we celebrate Toy Story's anniversary with your favorite scenes.
You actually think you're the Buzz Lightyear?
Exclusive interviews with the stars of the film.
Something was up on the screen that looked unlike anything that had ever been seen before.
And its creators at Pixar.
We believed in what we were doing. We believed in ourselves.
Welcome to Toy Story at 20, to infinity and beyond.
I'm Buzz Lightyear, Space Ranger, Universe Protection Unit.
Ed Catmull always had a dream of doing an animated feature film with computer animation. His dream became my dream as well.
The goal all along was to get to feature film. In order to get there, we had to develop the technology.
But we knew if we didn't have the story great, it wouldn't matter if we were using new technology.
We really wanted to prove that you could tell any kind of story that you wanted in animation.
Oh, well, thanks for the ride.
It's the story that counts, and this story was fantastic.
Steve Jobs said, if you do your job right, what you create can last forever.
This is important. Something really significant is happening here.
We were all part of something that was the work of some degree of sheer genius.
You did it!
It was a huge break that computer animation was even being sort of accepted as a medium.
And this is our first time we've ever done something longer than a short film.
It was incredibly complicated.
Any number of things could have gone wrong along the way.
I don't really remember ever having any thoughts of, we're in deep, you know, trouble. But we probably were.
We nearly failed a couple times, but we all stuck together.
Kids burst in, they throw down something on top of the bed.
How many times we redid this section?
And the reason was we believed in each other, even through the failures.
Much better than just cut to his point.
It'll be a great intro.
The potential was to spend $100 million. If you didn't have somebody as talented as John there, it would have probably been down a rat hole.
There was no way to know that the Toy Story movies were as special as they were until it was up there on the screen and made some sort of like quantum leap to create, you know, this brand new thing that was irrefutable.
February of 1986, Steve Jobs bought our group, the Lucasfilm Computer Division, from Lucasfilm, and we formed a separate company.
Steve Jobs acquired us because there was a kind of expertise in this group that didn't exist anywhere else.
When Pixar started, there was a real sense of excitement around computer graphics. Nobody knew exactly what it would be or what it could do, but Ed and the Pixar team were just totally committed to figuring it out.
Steve wanted us to continue doing computer animation research, always with an eye towards doing an animated feature film, which was our dream, which was our goal.
But we'd been waiting for a while because we had started in 1980 as a team, but we knew technology wasn't ready.
At the time, the predominant kind of animation was hand-drawn animation. Computer animation, it was incredibly complicated.
I was the only animator at Pixar forever.
I get the phone call from John Lasseter out of the blue saying, like you to come up and be our second animator in our department.
All of us, John Lasseter, Andrew Stanton, Joe Ramp, myself, we all studied hand-drawn animation.
You gotta remember, computers were not common, so I'd never touched one. I was like, what have I gotten myself into?
I had seen Luxo, this character that came out of this very familiar everyday object that had reactions that made me laugh, just the way it would turn and break the fourth wall and hop around.
I was in my college in the film school, and I saw that computer animation, that tensor light jumping on that beach ball. I loved it.
It was a magic that your eye could understand, but your brain couldn't quite fathom. This was so obviously a generational step up in this animated art form.
A film that we made in 1988 was a film called Tin Toy, which was a story about a little tin wind-up being menaced by a baby. The idea really came from watching, actually, a home video that my sister had taken of my nephew, who had just been born, sitting there playing with his favorite toys and immediately putting them into his mouth and slobbering on them. Tin Toy went on to win an Academy Award for Best Animated Short Film, which was the very first Oscar ever given to computer animation.
So the goal all along was to get to feature film.
By about 91, we were dabbling with the idea of maybe doing a Christmas special that involved Tinny from Tin Toy, and that would be a good next step to learning how to do longer format with computer animation.
So we started pitching this to all of the studios.
Peter Schneider, who was head of Disney Feature Animation at the time, called us one day and said, "We are interested in you guys possibly doing an animated feature film for us."
So I thought about it for one nanosecond and said, "Okay, it's our one shot. So what the hell?"
We're making a movie.
Really?
Yeah. Right?
We got it.
We were so excited. We were not amply scared. We should have been.
Coming up.
All of us were flying blind.
We never made a movie before, none of us.
We went from a tiny team that knew nothing to a bigger team that knew nothing.
This is new. This is daunting.
When Toy Story 20 to Infinity and Beyond continues.
It was weird. We didn't never made a movie before, none of us. It was like, what do you want to make?
When we were trying to come up with a story to tell, we had to look at the kinds of things that were relatively easy to do with computer graphics at the time.
I kept going back to the idea of toys being alive.
Whether we intended it or not, almost everything we made sort of looked like plastic. The idea of doing something with toys as characters was embracing the limitations of the technology.
You know, it's weird. I don't remember, like, interviewing at Pixar. They kind of just sent me up there, and there I was. I came in, it was still early days, nobody had been cast. There was definitely an air of, this is new, this is daunting and exciting. But it was always laced through with Lasseter's mandate, we're just making an animated movie. Forget about the tech.
This one right there, yeah.
Thank you, Steve.
Yep.
We decided to start by making a list of what we didn't want our film to be. We didn't want it to be a fairy tale.
We knew we didn't want this to be a musical.
We didn't want to make the same kinds of films that were being made at Disney.
And we weren't trying to make them the way that they were making them.
We wanted it to be something different.
Look out!
Ah! And then we figured out the buddy picture. The buddy picture is a genre of story that had never been done in animation before.
We're almost there!
We went back to our Tin Toy Christmas storyline. And in that, we had two characters. One was a ventriloquist dummy, the child's favorite toy. And on the kid's birthday, he gets a new toy. This tin toy that becomes his new favorite toy. And so how the old toy and the new toy deal with it.
As the story developed then, we realized, okay, a tin toy is probably not the most hip, current toy that we could come up with.
I looked in my own home, you know, to do research. I had five sons, and I watched what they played with. And they played with action figures.
Well, a lot of the guys had the G.I. Joes, and they were always like the envy of like the karate chop action, all the things. You can make their grip go back, you know, all that stuff we tried to pack into one toy, and that became Buzz.
Buzz Lightyear to Star Command. Come in, Star Command.
Then we started looking at the ventriloquist dummy.
They have the slots here, and, you know, as it turns out, those are kind of spooky. And I think it was Bud Lucky, who was one of the story guys we had just hired. He was a big cowboy fan himself, and so he was just drawing, and he said to John one day, what if we made Woody a cowboy?
And As soon as he said that, I go, yes, that's fantastic. Because it's a buddy picture, you want them to be as opposite as possible.
In the 50s, of course, cowboys were kind of replaced by spacemen in history and in pop culture.
And it's perfect, an old toy and a new toy.
Hi, pal, what you doing? I'm Tempest from Mars!
Yeah, what's his butt? Say, you weren't thinking of flying, were you?
Well...
You know, Andy loves toys that can fly.
Really? Well then, to infinity and beyond!
You know, Andy loves toys that he can find.
Andrew Stanton really, he had an intuitive understanding of who Woody was.
I learned a lot about how you could make somebody have selfish intentions, but have a selfless exterior. And that's how we finally cracked Woody. He really was in it for the room and wanted to help all the toys, but it was conditional as long as he was top toy. Once that got tested, it brought out a side of him he didn't even know he had.
How come you don't have a laser, Woody?
It's not a laser, it's a little light bulb that blinks.
What's with him?
Laser envy.
We knew this character was going to be flawed, but we still wanted him to be appealing.
He actually has a role he plays within the adult world of what the toys do in this room. He has to be a leader that everybody likes.
Tuesday night's plastic corrosion awareness meeting was, I think, a big success, and we want to thank Mr. Spell for putting that on for us. Thank you, Mr. Spell.
You're welcome.
And we kept coming back to this sort of Jimmy Stewart-like character we wanted.
And the first and only person we thought of for Woody was Tom Hanks.
You know, the way they always got everybody was they said, come be the voice of a Disney cartoon and you'll live forever and you'll delight your kids and your grandkids. That's how they got you. And you'd probably do it, you know, just for free coffee.
Hey, very good, Woody. That's using the old noodle.
We actually took some lines of dialogue from a movie he'd been in called Turner and Hooch, and we animated our test figure of Woody the cowboy to these really funny lines of dialogue of him getting so exasperated with his dog.
He was all bug-eyed and went down on the ground. He was pounding his fist. Don't eat the car! Don't eat the car! What are you doing? Are you eating the car?
No, you're eating the car! Don't eat the car! Not the car! No, you stupid car!
He saw that. He just laughed so hard, and he had us show it to him like 3 times in a row.
It didn't have the same motion. It didn't have the same sort of pattern that cellular animation had.
He actually said, I'm not even sure what I'm looking at. And we kind of got excited about that.
I said, great, great. I'm in.
Buzz!
Buzz!
We're thinking about who could be this, you know, space hero kind of action figure that could really be funny. And I was a huge fan of Tim Allen's stand-up routine.
The John came in and said, hey guys, listen to this. This is hilarious. And he is very funny.
Always wanted to do voiceovers, and I studied with some great voiceover talents that did commercials. So doing a voiceover was something it was in my wheelhouse. I always liked that idea.
Tim Allen, as an actor, brought a lot to that character and forced us to look at the character in a much more unique and specific way.
In the first recording session we did with Tim Allen as Buzz Lightyear, we originally had the idea that Buzz Lightyear was aware of the TV show that he was a part of. But when Tim came in, he played him so honest and real that we changed the idea of Buzz Lightyear after that recording session. We then realized, you know what? It would be so much better to have Buzz Lightyear not even know he's a toy.
Look, we're all very impressed with Andy's new toy.
Toy?
T-O-Y. Toy.
Excuse me, I think the word you're searching for is Space Ranger.
The fact that he didn't know lends a whole bunch of credibility to his character. He was full of himself, but there's a little humanity, if you will.
We thought we had the most perfect casting between these two guys.
Coming up, the story was really running into problems.
The wisecracks were almost too cracky.
Disney wanted to shut production down.
When Toy Story at 20 continues.
The technology was the restriction at the time. The most that we had ever made were commercials that were typically 30 seconds long, and we had made a few shorts were like 3 to 5 minutes in length. But to extrapolate from 5 minutes up to an hour and a half was a pretty big jump.
The technology was so primitive when we think about it comparatively to today.
Now, people take it for granted that when you need to move a file from one part of a building to another, you just send it over the network, right? Well, back when we made Toy Story, all that networking technology was in its infancy, so literally if an animator finished a shot, they would dump their shot out of the computer onto a videotape, and then somebody would ride a scooter through the hallways to bring the videotape to the department where we were editing the movie.
All right, men, you heard me. Code Red.
It feels like the movie was held together with spit and rubber bands.
It wasn't just developing the technology. We had to train more animators.
You have to remember, at this time, you couldn't go to any other studio and hire computer animators because there were very few other people that were doing it. So we had hired all these animators who came from hand-drawn and stop-motion backgrounds and were slowly teaching them to use the computer.
But at the time, just to be able to try to move the character and just get it to do what you wanted to do, there were so many times you're like, oh, if I could just touch it, I could get it to move exactly where I wanted to. Or for us that were raised hand-drawing, if we could just draw it, we'd be done.
And then there were those of us who came from a computer science background who were technologists. It really was the two of us sitting side by side.
Just click down there. The left button.
It was all really cutting edge, and a lot of it was being built by the technologists as we were going.
The thing that you couldn't deny was that when it was finished, it looked so real. It really looked as close as I'd ever seen that my own toys were coming to life. And the thrill of that would make you put up with all the hard work again of doing the next hard problem.
One of the things that John always likes to say is that the art challenges the technology and the technology inspires the art.
Doing our job right is really telling a great story and using this brand new technology to tell it.
A lot of times you'd look at the technology and it would completely inspire you, and so things would be added to the story that were completely based on inspiration that we would have by watching what these amazing technical people were putting together.
So what we don't ever want to do is forget the role of technology in adding energy into an art form, even though we know in the end it's the art and the storytelling that matters and has the effect on the audience.
Really wanted to prove way more than that you could make a CG picture, that you could tell any kind of story that you wanted in animation.
One of the key concerns from Disney was that this is going to be very juvenile. It's going to be only interesting for a little kid.
What's in it for adults? And the term they kept using was edgy.
We ended up going for much more snarky and sarcasm.
Save your batteries, people!
And so we got to a place where we had a screening of like the first half of the movie in story reel form.
Woody!
I'd just like to wish you luck. I know you'd do the same for me.
Oh, yeah, there you go. Whoa! Oh!
And it was terrible.
What are you... What's everybody looking at? What? Hey, he slipped. I tried to. I couldn't hold that. It was that he slipped.
We were young. We were inexperienced. So when we were being told, like, oh, what you're making is too juvenile, it's not edgy enough, it's not adult enough, we believed them. And it wasn't that the instinct was completely wrong. It was that the solution for how to make it smarter was wrong.
The wisecracks were almost too cracky.
You said your job was to think, Spring Wiener.
It was very abusive.
Trying to make Woody edgier and edgier made him so not likable, not a nice guy.
I'm sorry, Woody, but then I don't think what you did was right.
What? Am I hearing correctly? If it wasn't for me, Andy wouldn't pay any attention to you at all. In fact, my stretchy friend, you would have been hauled away to Goodwill a long time ago, so shut your mouth and get them off the bed.
It was really not the movie we set out to make. And it was a disaster that day. We've since coined it Black Friday. Disney wanted to shut production down. They said, clearly, you guys don't know how to do the feature film story on your own. We want you to come down.
And you guys are going to have to be much more supervised and micromanaged, and that's how we're going to fix this story.
And I thought, I can't do this to my crew.
And all of us had bought homes there in San Francisco after the green light. All of us were like, I'm not moving back.
We were just following what they wanted to do.
I think John's philosophy was, if we're going to go down, let us go down doing something that we believe in.
Give us 2 weeks. And if you don't like what you see in 2 weeks, then we will shut production down and move down there.
And when do we have to have this done by?
2 weeks.
Coming up.
There's nothing like fear as a motivator.
We were all holding our breath, but we believed in what we were doing.
Everything was riding on what could happen in the next 2 weeks.
When Toy Story 20 to Infinity and Beyond returns.
So we go show this to Disney, and Disney looks at it, and they say, well, we don't like this at all. They decided they weren't going to fund any more of the film. So now our company was completely at risk, and everything was riding on what could happen in the next 2 weeks.
John brought everyone together in the screening room, basically made an announcement about they're putting the brakes on it. Several of you are going to be fired, and Joss is here, so he's going to help us work that out. Like, don't put me in the same sentence.
We got nothing to lose. Let's go back to the first instincts and tone of what we were originally pitching that got kind of shot down, because that just feels right to us.
And we just started working day and night.
There's nothing like fear as a motivator. Fear of moving, fear of losing your job.
We were all holding our breath for those 2 weeks. But we believed in what we were doing. We believed in ourselves. And we just said, let's just make the movie we want.
Imagine you're never gonna have to show this to anybody. What would you wanna see? And that always tends to either be the answer or gets you out of the hole.
And we basically started making the film we wanted to make.
What did I tell you earlier? No one's getting replaced.
Joe and John and Pete and I would like banter about with story ideas, and Joss would be in the same room.
And I'd be like, okay, I got something. Go in my room and clickety-clack.
And a couple hours would go by, and out would come these pages that just completely read exactly the way we had described what we thought would work and better, and you couldn't help but picture the movie in your head.
We turned around in storyboard in 2 weeks from the beginning of the movie until Buzz Lightyear comes into the room and flies around the room. Can. Showed him the story reel of that.
Everybody was laughing, everybody was charmed.
And they were like, yeah, we like that, you know? Okay, and we turned production back on, and no one had to move down to Burbank, and we kind of saved the picture at that point in time. But we learned a real lesson, and that was to trust our instincts.
We really sort of learned our identity through that, so that's sort of being put through the fire like that.
This is a particularly well-crafted story. It's like any buddy comedy.
If it's a buddy picture, you need to have them be quite different from each other.
Woody and Buzz. One is very tall and prone to emotions.
One is very short and is very methodical.
One is made of cloth and is bendable and poseable.
One is made of metal and plastic and has things that pop out.
Impressive wingspan.
One of the key moments that really defined the characters of Woody and Buzz is this moment when Woody finally blows his top and he says,
"You are a toy!"
You know, they can't even see reality in the same way. And yet, by going through this journey together, they start to understand where the other one's coming from.
Even though these are toys, they're speaking to real things in our lives. That's why it appeals to adults.
What comes out of it is a love that is based on the deepest of friendships.
Hey, Buzz! You're flying!
This isn't flying. This is falling with style.
There is a perfect casting that went into this from the get-go.
Look, I'm Picasso!
In developing the other toys that's in Andy's room, we wanted to have toys that we had as kids, but also were available now.
This is not only an Etch-A-Sketch, but it's my Etch-A-Sketch as a little boy. Now, if you look closely, see right there what it says? Johnny, it's mine.
Many of the personalities of all the characters came at different times in different ways. Sometimes they were right there on the page. And sometimes it would be amplified by who we cast.
Sheriff, this is no time to panic.
No, this is the perfect time to panic.
You close your eyes as an animator, you're just listening to this guy's voice and thinking, can I see movement? Can I see expressions?
And you would start to tailor it more to that voice actor.
We learned from the animators at Disney who did movies like Jungle Book. If you look at that film, for example, the thing that's interesting in every sequence is the characters. And so this was our chance to do the same thing. You have this amazing group of comedians who can respond to anything.
Stay calm, everyone!
We wanted really funny actors.
This is a quality sound system. Probably all copper wiring, huh?
Ham's personality, he's a Weisenheimer.
What's going on down there? Is his mom losing her marbles?
He's the guy, well, you'd end up in a fight, he'd end up walking out with the girl.
Yeah, all right.
Hey, watch it!
Sorry there, old spudhead.
A good soldier never leaves a man behind.
My manager, the way he sold it to me, is he called me up and said, guess what, Gunny? They want you to be a little Green Army guy.
There they are.
And so I jumped on it. I said, sure, count me in. I'm going to do it.
As a bunch of animators who were still struggling to learn how to move things in the computer.
Yes, sir.
It was really a challenge.
Red alert, red alert.
That base underneath that they're stuck to, that's going to stay stuck to them.
How are these things going to walk, you know? It was very comical.
John's thought was remain true to what those characters are.
Ow! What in the world?
So I got a board and some old shoes, and I nailed the shoes to the board. We filmed each other trying to run with our feet nailed to a board. It ended up really helping a lot.
How are you doing, Rex?
Were you scared? Tell me honestly.
Rex, the dinosaur. It's supposed to be the most fearsome creature that walked the earth, but look at it. And it's got these pathetic little arms that can't even scratch its own nose. It would have an inferiority complex, and that's when we came up with the idea of Wally Shawn.
What if Andy gets another dinosaur? A mean one. I don't think I can take that kind of rejection.
Hey, come on, potato head.
There's something about Slinky's, you know, it's all okay. It's his very chillax kind of approach to life. I'm a big Slinky fan.
I think they've never seen a new toy before.
Well, sure, look at him. He's got more gadgets on him than a Swiss Army knife.
She was the only girl in the first one.
I know Andy's excited about Buzz, but you know he'll always have a special place for you.
It's kind of a Mae Westy kind of quality about her double entendres.
My Christmas share.
It's just different from regular acting.
You uncultured swine! What are you looking at, you hockey puck?
Don Rickles.
Don Rickles.
I can't get enough of Don Rickles.
Toy Story shines a spotlight on certain, you know, really talented treasures that the next generation might not be aware of, and I think Don Rickles is a great example.
You can't imagine Potato Head without that great voice coming in.
Potato Head?
That's Mr. Potato Head to you, you backstabbing murderer.
You know, he can insult people, and it's hilarious.
We got a call from John Lasseter. I know, he sits in the house and plays with toys. He's a grown man.
But I handed him a Mr. Potato Head, and he was there holding it. It's casting of the century, I think, Don Rickles.
Absolutely.
I realized it looked just like him.
That used to be a wart, and now it's a whole doll.
I always thought all those toys and kids were all going to be together sitting on the floor with a microphone. And you sit, it's like a trial.
You aren't a real Buzz Lightyear, you're an action figure!
You're not facing the screen, you're facing all the other producers and writers of the film. Wait a minute, you don't think I meant to knock Buzz out the window, do you?
Sometimes you can see them because there's a reflection behind the booth.
I alone have the information that reveals this weapon's only weakness.
And be looking at something akin to the communist judges at the Olympics. We thought that was okay, Tom. You got a 7.
And you make funny noises. Gee, I better shave. And they all get up.
Show me how you can be angry. Save it for the jury. I hope Sid pulls your voice box out, you creep.
And you go, and I go, that's good. What do you think, John?
Hey, what do you think?
Hey, Lou, you think it's any good?
You go over and over and over this stuff.
He'll kill us all!
And I go, why am I doing this? Why?
Mrs. Potato Head! Mrs. Potato Head!
Hey, I can dream, can't I?
John, to you and your wonderful company, don't call me anymore. Don't call
me. Coming up.
There was still a lot of pressure from Disney, I think coming from the great tradition of having all the great music in Disney films.
There was only one name that came to mind for me.
Those days recording Toy Story, those are the best days of my life.
When Toy Story 20 to Infinity and Beyond returns.
So here we are developing Toy Story, working on this story.
And there was still a lot of pressure from Disney, I think coming from the great tradition of having all the great music in Disney films.
And we went, we were kind of thinking that we wouldn't have any songs in the film. But our savior is a guy named Chris Montan, who is the executive music producer for Disney. He explained how songs can actually help explore and tell an emotion that you can't get across with just dialogue.
Not breakout in songs, not sung by the characters, but still about what's happening.
We said we can do songs if we do it like this. Then we started thinking about who can we have do this. There was only one name that came to mind for me was Randy Newman.
Randy Newman was so inspiring to us because he was emotional and yet he was not sentimental.
I used to always say he sold sincerity through insincerity, and I felt like that was a perfect representation of us.
I was first contacted about Toy Story by John Lasseter and liked him. He explained that it was a computer animation and that he thought that the picture might need warming up because it was computer.
The first song we wanted him to write was a song that we would use at the beginning of the film to explore the relationship that Woody has with Andy. But then at the end of the film, the same lyrics meant Buzz Lightyear and Woody's relationship.
John said that he wanted it to be about the special friendship. You've got a friend in me.
And he goes, I got something for you. And he sat there and sang, You've Got a Friend in Me. And we all looked at each other and went, this is amazing.
You got a friend in me. If you got troubles, then I got them too. There isn't anything I wouldn't do for you.
I went once when Randy Newman was conducting and heard the orchestra in the room. I was like, oh, this is the best feeling I'm ever gonna have.
Those days recording Toy Story, those are the best days of my life, recording with the orchestra. I love them.
Nice job.
We worked on the film for many years and probably didn't even think about whether it would be a big success. We were just concentrating on getting it done.
We're kind of holding our breath because we've worked 4 years on this film. It's our baby.
4 years is a long time to work on anything. So by the time we finally were showing it to other people, I think we personally liked it so much it almost didn't matter what the rest of the world thought. I mean, we cared deeply that it would be well received because we wanted another opportunity to do it. But I don't think we would have questioned that the movie was good or bad. We really liked it.
You know what's funny? I never thought of it at all as anything special in terms of, this just shows you where my little vision of the thing was, I'm having a great time making this with my friends. We're getting to challenge what I've always loved about animation and push things in new directions. That was the joy of it to me. The fact that anyone was ever gonna see this or it would go out into the world never occurred to me until it actually happened.
We finished the film in the late fall. Then the movie opens on Thanksgiving, you know, weekend, and it becomes a number one film, and people just loved it.
The premiere that was at the El Capitan Theater, to sit in that fabulous movie palace and have this, honestly, a brand new art form on display for everybody there for the first time. Something was up on the screen that looked unlike anything that had ever been seen before.
And the best part of this is El Capitan on a Saturday with a bunch of kids and families watching this magic happen.
When Toy Story came out, almost all the reviews only had one or two lines about the fact that it was computer generated. The rest of the review was about the movie. That meant we had succeeded. not just in demonstrating we could use computer animation, but we had succeeded as a film studio.
Even though the movies are appropriate for children, there's a level of intelligence to the comedy and to the writing that I, as an audience member, appreciate, and certainly as a parent.
The notion of great films touching people's hearts, I think, is really important, and Toy Story is one that truly touched people's hearts.
Because it was the first thing I'd ever done that came out on this scale that got seen by people around the world, it really surprised me. I had no idea how it would play, and I never really thought about it.
We made a movie. Wow.
It was exciting.
I knew these guys were onto something. I mean, it felt right.
To see the world rendered in that way was extremely groundbreaking.
It was one of those moments where you watch a film and the lights come up and you just are thinking everything's gonna change.
I remember dropping my son off at preschool and kids on the playground were running around saying to Infinity Beyond and all these other lines that I'd written. And that freaked me out. That really freaked me out.
Anytime you can make an impact on children, it's a good thing.
What an amazing occurrence to have an animated film do this. I'm glad to be part of it. It's startling to be part of an iconic thing, but I take ownership of Buzz and I get very protective about that character.
The definition of a good movie is one that works, and one that works emotionally. Toy Story resonates for the audience because it's a good movie.
Coming up, if somebody had told me that we'd be here 20 years later, I would say, what the heck is going on? Because we were amazed we got to make a movie.
I'm delighted to be part of it.
It makes me feel like I'm the luckiest guy in the world.
When Toy Story 20 to Infinity and Beyond continues.
I've always liked the moment where Woody uses Buzz's arm in the window to try to flag down his friends across the way and convince them that Buzz is actually okay when he's faking it the entire time. And, hey, Buzz, let's do this best friend's handshake and give me five. Hey, you know, and he's playing with his severed arm. And it's the funniest thing.
My favorite sequence of all time is Tim's as Buzz, when he does that incredible loop-de-loop all over Andy's bedroom. And because I've been saying, you're a toy, you're a child's plaything, you can't fly, you cannot fly. And then he does this incredible thing, and the final line is, can! And at that moment, he accepts that there is an equal in the room, and the moment that he does that, he begins to make the great friendship of his life.
You are a toy!
Woody's,
you are a toy.
I do it better than actually Hank says. I should have been more a cowboy with a spacesuit. Buzz Woody. Woody Buzz. Anyway, when he's screaming at me and he says, you are a toy, and I said, you are a sad, strange little man, and you have my pity. Farewell. Definitely one of my favorite lines in the movie.
If somebody had told me that we'd be here 20 years later, I would say, what the heck is going on? Because we were amazed we got to make a movie.
Animation as we knew it had changed completely.
I think the most lasting legacy has been the impact that Pixar's storytelling has had.
What made me want to be a part of every film Pixar's ever made? It's like you've been invited into a very special sandbox. And they share their toys, too.
I'm delighted to be part of it. You see this mansion. I mean, it was really because of Lasseter and his little toys and his Mickey Mouse stuff.
You Got a Friend in Me is one of my most popular songs, certainly. When I play it live, people sing along, and you see 19-year-olds and 25-year-olds sort of crying and holding hands. It's very heartening for me.
You know that if you're going to see a Pixar movie, you're seeing the next step in a legacy that Toy Story flipped the first card over for. And I have to say, they haven't really let me down as an audience member.
One of the big payoffs is, you know, children know you forever. They go, I know your voice. I had a nice little gig going for myself for a while. I was the story lady at my children's school, and I just went from classroom to classroom, and they would often call me Bo Peep. Bo Peep's reading today. And, you know, I enjoyed that.
get parents coming up to me and saying, oh, you know, my kids love, you know, Hammy the Pig, you're their favorite character. And they say, is there anything you want them to do? You know, eat their broccoli, go to bed earlier, do their homework. And so they tell me, so, hey, this is Hammy the Pig. You know, I didn't get to be big and strong like this by staying up all night. So you get to bed right now.
A kid was misbehaving in an elevator. He was, you know, being a seven-year-old. And really punching his mom in the thigh. You know, so I went to infinity and beyond. And the kid stopped what he's doing, looked at me, and he did a few more things. You are a sad, strange little man. And then he shuddered and looked like he was going to pass out. And then he's crying all the way out that that ugly man swallowed Buzz Lightyear.
A mom and dad come in with a kid, and the parents say, oh, this is Woody, you know, from Toy Story. And the kids just see a guy in an elevator. And then I say, come on, Buzz, we got to get back to Andy's room quick. They always go, it makes me feel like I'm the luckiest guy in the world, that I'm part of this thing that has gone down in cinematic history as lightning in a bottle.
Let me read you this letter. It says, Dear John Lasseter, we had a young child about 6 years old come into Walt Disney World. He brought with us his well-played Woody doll. It's right here. His parents bought him a new one, and he wanted his first one to have a great new home. So he left it here to spend infinity and beyond with Buzz Lightyear. As you can see, he has been loved very much over the years. Thank you for giving everyone great characters that have a heart. Sincerely, the Magic Kingdom Guest Relations cast. This is why I do what I do.
You got a friend in me. You got a friend in me. When the road looks rough ahead and you're miles and miles from your nice warm bed, you just remember what your old past said. Boy, you got a friend in me. Yeah, you got a friend in me.